Hi, this is Pastor Bob Kraft, and you're with Conversations with Bob. This is a five-minute series of discussions about topics that are relevant to tennis and Christian faith today, and also tools that can help you. Our website is www.tennisministry.org. Today's an interesting topic. I wanted to speak about Justine Henin. She recently retired, and you know, she's been a great champion. I've actually been around her a lot, and I've spent a lot of time sitting with her. And things that sometimes the media would write reports that were not accurate, or maybe they had a view that wasn't one, you could just say one-sided. And I would actually be on another side, and I would see something totally different, but it was never reported. Justine has been a great champion. I think she's always been somebody who's never created any disrespect for the sport. The media has presented a certain image of her, and sometimes it's not been very fair. So I would just like to share my own experiences. I actually met her in the year 2002. I was introduced to her through a coach, and her coach, Carlos Rodriguez, actually sat with him many tournaments, starting with the U.S. Open, as I remember. It could have been the Australian, because that was really my first tour tournament. And I would sit at the table and with her and Carlos, her coach, and also could have been her boyfriend at that time, or maybe her husband. But at some point, her husband, she got married to Yves. And I would sit at the table. And they knew I was a pastor, and I would give them material, simple material in French or English. And they were always nice to me, and I was able to talk about Christian things. Most of the conversation centered around tennis, but I would, you know, over a period of time, I would be able to interject Christian ideas. And they hadn't really grown up with that. Carlos had, actually. He grew up in the Catholic Church, but he was very supportive of me. And I would give him materials. And they would look at him, and they'd be nice. They'd kind of, and they'd set him on the table. But, you know, the epitome of, actually I could say, rudeness, is they would get up from the table and my material would still be there. And so I would just have to go and pick the material up, because someone had bought the material, and we didn't want to waste it. And I would put it back in my pocket, and I just was patient. And that went on for year after year. So I would sit at the tables, and I'd give them material. I'd talk, and they'd leave it at the table. They'd get up. They'd leave it at the table. And, you know, we'd always smile at each other. We'd talk when we'd pass each other in the hallway. But that was the status. Then Justine got married, and, you know, I sat with them, and they were happy. In fact, just before she announced her plans to divorce, I was with him just to say a month or two before, and they were very happy. And one thing I've learned about divorce is sometimes it comes on very quickly. The cracks are there, but they don't deal with the cracks. And when it falls apart, it's a very sudden thing. And there's not the maturity there or people around them to support them. So it was a really surprise that their divorce took place. But it rattled her, you know, a lot. Now, she's still playing tournaments. She's doing well. Where Justine, I think, first respected me was when I was working with Mary Pierce, and she was in the finals against Mary Pierce a few years ago at the French Open, and everybody saw the work that I was doing with Mary Pierce, and that had a huge statement to the pro players, especially the women, because she was well-respected, she was a top player, and everybody saw what happened to her, the results that took place, and how she was able to calm herself down. And here I am sitting in the players' box of the finals when she played against Mary. Now, she crushed Mary, but in fact, you know, that started the relationship in a deeper way. From that point on, I sat with her, and I had more authority, I could say, over what I was doing, and she would listen much more carefully. She went through the divorce. From that moment on, her life changed a little bit. She was sad, for sure, but at the same time, she was wanting to get out of a situation that was uncomfortable, and her coach would support her in saying that you need to have more more to think about with life than just tennis, and I was working with him at that time. Now, something that happened was at the Australian Open when she, just before the final, I was actually sitting at a table, just she and I were sitting at the table in the players' lounge. Hardly anyone else was there, and she was getting ready to go play. As I remember right, it was Maresmo, but I can't be sure. She pulled out of the final because she was sick, and she played like a set, and she lost. And when we were sitting there, she was eating spaghetti, and we were talking, and she played the final, and the media really came hard on her about how she threw the match. And I was with her, and I knew she was fine, but I also knew that she ate something, and, you know, I know Justine well enough to know that she gives her all, 100%. So the media pressure was actually something that hurt her a lot, and I think it drew her closer to faith. She retired rather abruptly, and I didn't really see that coming. I saw her maybe that year, a year later at Wimbledon, and she came up to me. And again, I've been giving her material, of talking to her for probably an eight-year period. And she said, Bob, I want what you've been offering me. And I gave her a book that was in French. It's called Purpose-Driven Life. It talks about how people can have faith in God and kind of answers a lot of questions. And she took that from me, and she said, do I need to pay you for this? And I said, no, I said, it's free. It's a free gift from me to you. God gave me a free gift. And she took it, and she got in the car, and she drove away. Now, she had retired at that time, and she went, and from what I heard, she put a lot of things into a different perspective in her life during this time away from the game. She came back, and I really saw her briefly, but I wasn't around her much. There was another person around her who is a Christian coach who probably has some negative influence too in her life. And so the relationships was not as strong. It became more about tennis again and not about where you are as a person. But what I would like to say is that, you know, when God works in a person's life and he touches you, you're touched. And forever you can... you're never the same. So even though things are difficult now, maybe in some ways, you know, God is working in a person's life and opens doors and closes doors. And maybe in the future I'll see her again and it'll be the right time for me to speak, and maybe not. But most importantly is I can pray for her and I can lift her up. But for sure, during this 10-year period, her fate played a lot to do with who she was as a person. Her marriage, her divorce, her retirement, her coming back, and I would assume now that she's retired a second time. So we wish Justine the best, and we wish Carlos the best, and, you know, my prayer for them would be that they will put God first and not tennis, and God will come first, their relationship with Christ, and all the other things will fall into place, their family relationships, their profession, and all the things that take place. So, you know, that's, I just wanted to share that about Justine. She's a real person, and she's got a lot of things she's working on, as we all are, but I believe God is going to end up as the eventual champion in her life. So thanks a lot, and have a good day.